The path can seem like a paradox. For example, now that I'm realizing and seeing that the purpose and goal of this world, of being, of thinking that you're a body, the viewpoint and attention of a body in this world, it's really dedication to failure, dedication to failure. Now that I realize just how dedicated to failure this world is, those who come here are so dedicated to it. Paradoxically, that has freed me up. And I realize, wow, the attempts to help and not being able to help isn't because I'm wrong or there's something weird or something not right or anything. No, it's simply because they're so dedicated to failure here. Thinking, believing that failure is success. I finally understood why they believe failure is success. It's an upside down, backwards situation. So seeing it, then it is very liberating because you say, oh, great, the Holy Spirit will easily, eventually and easily lead them to success. And they'll recognize, they'll turn it around from failure to success. There's nothing out of whack at all. It is simply the tremendous dedication to failure that is at play. That's it. And so this is like giving me a super positive vibe, actually. There's nothing wrong with anyone. They're just dedicated to failure. And they can't fail. You see, they cannot fail. No matter how dedicated they are, they cannot fail. So it'll just be a matter of, you know, eventually, the Holy Spirit will turn them from that. That's all. So there's no concern about anybody, really, truly. The trouble is, in coming to this world, we underestimate the dedication to failure that is present here. So we tend to get frustrated, and then we tend to think that there's something inherently wrong. No, there's nothing inherently wrong at all. There is simply this extremely severe continuity fear, unacknowledged, that leads to a tremendous dedication towards failure, believing that failure is success. That's it. There isn't any mystery anymore in this situation for me. It's very liberating. I'm feeling very positive, actually. It's incredibly simple what's going on here. Instead of something incredibly complex, you see. We stress out because we believe there's something very complex taking place. It's not true at all. It's, at its root, is utterly simple. We believe that failure is success. In other words, failure to set down our stance of hallucination is how we successfully maintain our identity. That's, you see, that's the formula that we have here. Those who come to this world have this formula. Okay, failure to set down our stance of hallucination equals success in maintaining our identity. See, that's, so they do everything they possibly can. They're dedicated to not setting down the stance of hallucination. Whereas the spiritual path is dedicated to setting down the stance of hallucination, whereby we are reacquainted, reaware, we become aware again of our true identity, our one and only, the one and only true identity there is. So most in this world do everything they can to sabotage success. If you're trying to bring them success, they will do everything they can to sabotage your success. Of course, they will do it with a smile, and you're their friend, and you know all this, but they're still absolutely tremendously locked into this formula. Success is failure, success is failure, success is failure. Got to protect that stance of hallucination. That's my identity depends on it. So they will just deflect any and all help towards recognizing that you can set down the stance of hallucination. They will defend against that at all costs. So that's why it seems like we make no headway at all. But the eventual freedom of everyone is guaranteed. So why ultimately do we need to stress out? The Holy Spirit will take care of it. And there's really very little anyone can do as long as people are unrepentantly locked into this formula of failure equals success. And they will project their unhappiness onto others and then attack others. And that keeps the whole thing going. Okay. Well, taking the stance of hallucination means believing that what you're hallucinating is actually responsible for the hallucinator, the one who's doing the hallucinating. This is the problem with hallucination. So to really lift our spirits, we need to recognize there is this fundamental issue. We wanted to be greater than God. Okay, we wanted to be greater than God. That's what the origin of, the ultimate origin of all this is. We took the stance of a hallucinator. And we won't work through all the whys, etc. We took the stance of a hallucinator where we have misinterpreted reality as objectified. I believe that reality is now something objective, and we're the subject, so to speak. That it's all objective. It's a hallucination. But when we see that, we think, wait a minute. What I believe myself to be before, the oneness, must be a hallucination. So if this is real, the other has to be a hallucination. So then you say, wow, I can't go back to that, or I'll be nothing. So I've got to keep this subject-object situation going. And in order to do that, then we believe that we're merely an object of what we're hallucinating. We're merely an object of nature, is essentially what we believe. That nature, we've been made by nature. We've been made by our hallucination is responsible for our existence. That this misinterpretation is responsible for our being, what we are. So then we don't dare drop our stance of hallucination because we think what we are will disappear. So at all costs, we make sure we fail to drop the stance of hallucination. Make sure we're a failure at that, an absolute failure. And we think that by maintaining this failure, we're succeeding at life, keeping our existence, which we call life. Ultimately, we want to see if we can find a way to make it permanent, where there's no possibility of ever dropping the stance of hallucination. No possibility whatsoever. So we concoct all sorts of schemes with that hope in mind. Never gets there. But we also bury this. And any talk about we're not succeeding is buried too. So this world just buries and buries and buries wisdom, success, help, advice. It just buries it. And thereby believes it is succeeding in protecting life, in protecting its identity. See that? How terrible it really is. It's like, wow. So Jesus said, when you come here and try to help out people, the world's going to hate you. That's a very strong word, hate. Jesus said the world's going to hate you. But just keep in mind, it hated me first. Yeah, I really hated Jesus. That is for sure. This is why. So now, once we see this, we realize, wow, there is a big picture. There is a way to look at this whole situation simply. It was very simple. And of course, this world hates simplicity. It wants it to be super complex. It insists, oh no, the spiritual path is super complex. All this stuff, wow, it just goes on and on and on and on and on and all the complexities of it. Now, So on the spiritual path, what we really need to do is keep insisting. It's very simple. It's very simple. But how do we go from this super defensive position that failure is success, trying to institutionalize failure and defending at all costs against seeing the simplicity of it, therefore demanding that it be super complicated and complex, and your mind needs to be engaged in all this complexity? How do we go from that to the truth of utter simplicity of it? Well, gradually. And that's why there are four basic phases on the spiritual path. Phase 1, 2, 3, and 4, which lead to the fifth state, which is real true freedom. True freedom. No more continuity fear. Dropping the stance of hallucination. The fifth phase is when the stance of hallucination has been dropped. It's no longer there. You're no longer hallucinating. That's the fifth. That's the goal. That's the vision of oneness. When you're in the fifth phase, you're abiding in the vision of oneness. And the first phase usually starts when you get just a glimpse of this vision of oneness. Somehow, just for a moment, you have a glimpse and you say, wow, something isn't right. And you begin to question and think. And so you go through this first phase where you're still locked into all this complexity. You see, what do I do with all this complexity? Continuity fear says if you don't have it, you're going to cease to exist. So we're all worried about, wow, I saw something that was so simple and total, and yet I have all this complexity. What do I do? How do I integrate the two? So you go through all this laborious time of thinking you need to integrate it some way, complexity and simplicity. And the first phase is just this sort of a gradual reorientation. And you may puff yourself up and think that you've got it, when a lot of the first phasers think they totally understand it all, and they're, you know, that's part of that. But then they say, well, maybe not. Maybe if I die, I'll understand it. And no, and they hope so. They hope death is to solve the complexity of a situation. It doesn't. It doesn't. Now the second phase, getting into the second phase is very interesting. I got into the second phase. Had a series of awakenings where I was shown the dualistic delusion of this world. And I was shown all of this during sleep, actually. And I saw I was going to sink back into delusion, and then I became aware this was because I was the continuity fear, like I had, you know, I was too afraid to set delusion down. And then I was aware that if I just did a lot of effort and right effort, I would eventually be free of all this fear. So then I really started working intensely. That's the second phase. I also realized my previous lives, and I realized that death did not solve my problem at all. And that was extremely helpful. Because at that point, I absolutely gave up on death solving my problems, 100%. Which meant it was totally up to my effort, you see. It's not going to be solved through any natural process, a process of nature. Any process of arising, sustaining, and dissolving, that is not going to solve my problem whatsoever. So I said, wow, it's up to me and the Holy Spirit. And I became aware of the Holy Spirit at that time. That's the second phase. And so the second phase, you start saying, okay, how do I simplify? And gradually, you get used to more and more simplicity during the second phase. Then, eventually, you've simplified it. You're so used to simplification, you want something that's less cumbersome as far as perspective. And then you're able to get into almost like a shorthand sort of way of looking at the situation. And you get used to this shorthand way of looking at it. Very, very abbreviated and quick and big picture, always focusing big picture, simple. You do that, that can take quite some time of effort. And then you come across some super shorthand that just sums it up beautifully, and just a summation, just nothing but a summation. So the fourth phase is just this summation, final summation. which leads to then dropping the stance of hallucination, abiding in the vision of oneness, fifth phase. And we're not talking about any phases past the fifth phase whatsoever. Once you're abiding in the vision of oneness, that's it. And ultimately, you go even beyond that. But it's a mistake to focus on that at all. Actually, it actually causes problems if you even think about it. Forget it. That God takes the last step, okay? Not us. So our goal is entirely of phase 1, 2, 3, 4, getting to the vision of oneness, stage 5, that phase 5, that's it. So we're not playing spiritual one-upmanship here. We're saying, yeah, well, I got to stage 6, and yeah, I got to stage 7, I got to phase. That's spiritual one-upmanship. That has no place here, actually. It is supreme to get this to stage 5, where you release the stance of hallucination. Then you are enlightened. You are enlightened. You are abiding in the vision of oneness. All confusion gone. And then you just get used to abiding in that. That's it. That's it. So the spiritual path is goes towards simplification, 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 like that. Big picture, big picture, big picture, big picture, big picture. That. Summation, 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 summation. Training, training, training yourself. Do not allow your mind to get pulled into all this dialogue and questions and argumentation. Do everything you can to stay very much focused on exercises. I am, I am, I am, I am, I am. Only the I amness. All is 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 I amness. And you allow yourself to feel the celebration of success. You practice that feeling it like. And just practice the entire universe clapping for you. I had a dream like that. I went to like Fenway Park, some baseball stadium. It was somebody was a little different than that. And I was like a baseball player of some sort. I arrived at the stadium. And I heard the crowd early, I arrived early, and the stands were packed. And they were all standing and chanting and clapping, you know, and it's like incredible. Went on and on and on and on and on and on as I was preparing for the game. Yeah, and it just got louder and louder, and people were just ecstatic, and then I realized, I was aware, they were all clapping for me. They're waiting for me to come out on the field. You know, they had all come there, and they weren't waiting for me to appear to start clapping. They were all just, you know, before the game started, an hour or two before the game started, totally cheering and clapping and jumping and jubilation. They were just like ecstatic. It's like, wow. It was like super intense. I said, wow, this is great. Just this, you know, enormous, like, gratitude. So what you need to feel is this universal gratitude. Just imagine the entire universe is, like, ecstatic over you reaching level phase 5. Everyone's ecstatic about it. Because ultimately, you're helping everyone. You're giving everyone, all in the universe, all beings, you're giving them an enormous boost by reaching phase 5. All of them, everyone. That's why there were so many people there. They were just like super elated to, so happy to see me. And I didn't know who they were. It didn't matter to them. So we need to allow ourselves to feel the gratitude that it will come to us when we, you know, turn this whole situation around. It's a big deal. Spiritual path is a big deal. Because believing that failure is success is a big deal, isn't it? Because that locks us into a cage, a prison cage of futility and misery and depression and suffering and death and littleness and loneliness and despair and isolation and separation, and it's hideous, it's hell. And without those who show the way and do it, where is the motivation? Where is the confidence? Where is the hope for those who are trapped in this position, feel pinned down in this position, hopelessly pinned down, that failure is success, that they must keep the stance of Lewis Nation, and they're defending against us so strongly, they see no possibility of it ever changing. So, but deep down, they feel this horrible sense of failure, like there's no way I can ever succeed. And yet, they're making sure that they maintain this feeling, like I can never succeed, and hoping one day it will turn into this feeling of success, of true happiness, hoping in vain. So you can imagine how the spirits of everyone must feel, truly feel, when anyone is truly liberated from this. So it's a big deal. And I've always said the continuity fear centers around our success. We're very frightened of our success because it is a big deal. Let me bump this up. Light's always changing in this world, isn't it? It's a huge deal. That's why I came to the stadium and I said, what's going on? The stands are absolutely packed hours before the game. And they said, they're all here to see you. I said, wow. I said, there's a big deal. And they wouldn't stop. Not only wouldn't stop, it just kept getting greater and greater and greater and greater and greater. And it's like, holy smokes. And this was just pointing out to me, being liberated is a very big deal. So of course our continuity fears like, whoa, I don't want that much success. And so again, the continuity fear centers around you fear success. It's going to be too much. Two things. It centers around, of course, fear of annihilation, which you know isn't true. So ultimately it boils down to just continuity fear, like, wow, I don't want to have too much success here. It's just like, wow, it's too much. So it helps during these phases when you are contacted by those who have done it, who have zero continuity fear now, who have abided in the fifth phase, vision of oneness, and have even been, by God has even then brought them into the fullness of awareness of perfection. It helps if they contact you from time to time. Just so you can get used to that. It's just like, wow. I was contacted by this great teacher. I was contacted by someone who's just like a great, you know, saint, a great sage or something. Yeah, sort of like rubbing elbows with greatness a little bit. And then you have to start adjusting your sights. I remember many instances, and I was just like almost freaked out, really. I said, wow, Jesus is meeting with me during sleep. And I was just like, oh my God, this is absolutely incredible. Absolutely incredible. and it is just like, how could this be? Who am I? I'm nothing. It puts a lot of strain, a lot of stress, a lot of responsibility. But then you start saying, hey, I better live up to this somehow. So, of course, being truly liberated into the fifth phase is a gigantic deal for everyone. And you have to, you know, accept it. That's part of the thing. You have to accept it. You know, the people, they may not express it in this time and world and time, etc. But what I was shown in the dream was just how they really felt beyond the stance of feeling that success, failure is success, this fear-based defensive stance, which is ultimately is held on to because of the continuity fear. I was able to experience how they really feel about it, you know. So that's very different than what you get in the world. Like people, like they act like they don't even know you. In fact, you're the last person in the world they want to know. Yeah, because you're harming their failure, which they see as success. They don't like that. I was driving the truck. I rarely look at the speedometer, the odometer, or anything. Suddenly, I need to look. I glance. It was 1111. Four ones in the fourth phase of oneness, you see. And that's, you know, that's preparing for the fifth phase. That's preparing for liberation, actually. It's right there. And there's no way that people are not going to be ecstatically happy, actually. You know, you can't prevent it. You know, if you're in this incredible dungeon down, you know, a million levels, you're in this pit, and you're so far down and you think you're never going to get out of this pit, and then someone realizes there is no pit at all. There's never been any layers or levels, no time, space, process, or form. No one has ever suffered, truly suffered, at all. No one's ever been in any threat whatsoever. No one's ever experienced the slightest real threat whatsoever. That their sanity is completely untouched. Absolutely sane. Everyone's absolutely sane. Reality's totally sane. There's no threat to reality whatsoever. You know, realizing this, knowing it, realizing it. You know, those spirits that believe they're locked in this pit for all eternity. Some little light gets into them and they say, wow, I'm not. That's a huge deal for them. Huge. You cannot underestimate it. That's why Jesus is such a big deal. You know, Jesus is a very big deal. In case some people don't realize that, it's a very big deal. He said, look, even in the face of most gruesome death, most gruesome injustice, and you think the world's totally unfair, that the universe is insane. Look, Jesus is being crucified, completely insane. All of this, you know, just you think you're in this, just you're locked into the sacrificial, delusional, you know, this hellish, egoic stance. And Jesus said, no. See, you will resurrect from this. You will be free. You will be liberated from this. And so, of course, everyone deep down, this registered with everyone. Mind is one. So, whatever experience one has, everyone has. And so, but experiencing that there's no threat at all, that experience cannot be threatened. Those who believe that there's some threat, they're not really experiencing. They're waiting for this experiencing, but it never happens. That's not truly shared, you see. It's experiencing that's shared. It's sanity that's shared. We're not insane, we're waiting to be insane, but it's never going to happen. But of course, as you wait for it, you seem to be insane. At least it seems plausible to say that, but no one's insane. No one's in any pit. No one has any threat to their being whatsoever. Everything is perfectly fine. So Jesus, you know, knew this, was experiencing it, and everyone said, wow, this is a huge deal. This is huge, you know, very, very, very significant and grateful. So, Jesus has been an extremely big deal. There's an example. Now, in the desire to streamline salvation and get away from complexity, what people do in the first phase is to say, there's only one has ever gotten free. No one else has ever gotten free. So it's phase one often fixates on a particular someone who has gotten free. Islam might fix on Prophet Muhammad. Tibetan Buddhism might fixate on one of the great Rinpoches, one of the great Buddhism might fixate on Gautama Buddha, Christianity on Jesus. Phase one is you're so happy that the idea of simplicity, you think, oh, I can get it easy. I just believe in Jesus is the only way. And that's it, I've got it. That's idealism, it's spiritual idealism. But that is not enough. That is, see, they hope, if I just do that, that'll succeed. But simplicity has to encompass the entire context. It requires phase 2, 3, and 4, getting to 5. Simplicity has to go all the way to the vision of oneness. But those in phase one who are just getting started, they're very enthusiastic, and they say, oh, I know simplicity is possible, right? Which is true. And I know Jesus is going to bring me there, which is true. But then they say, you know, I don't want to think about any complexity around this, so I'm just going to say that there's nobody else that can ever help me. That's it. And so that's part of the situation. But eventually you realize phase two and phase three, you realize there's been quite a few who have been liberated from delusion, who have reached phase five of abidance and oneness. And even God has liberated them, he brought them to full awareness of reality. So, and that doesn't bother you in the slightest bit, because you realize the simplicity that you're going for is way deeper than you realized. The oneness is not meaning only one person, one of us can be liberated. The oneness means none of us ever fell in the first place. None of us ever fell. No one's ever fallen. That's what we mean by simplicity. Okay. So ultimately, there's nothing to be saved from. Ultimately, there is no savior at all, because none of us have ever fallen. There's not been any fall whatsoever. There's no pit. We never fell into any pit. So the feeling is just like everything is perfectly fine with everyone. The vision of oneness is this abidance in the realization. Everything is absolutely perfectly perfect for all. The one family of the totality. All is well with this one family. Perfectly well. All is perfect with this one family. The one, the only family there is. Nobody needs to be pulled out of any pit. So the first phase is say, okay, we believe someone's going to pull me out of the pit, and I want to focus all my attention on that one who's going to pull me out of the pit. I don't want to be thinking about anyone else. So that's understandable, right? If you think you're in a pit and you're reaching your hand up, please, you know, help me, help me, help me, and you see someone up there, do you want to be like trying to choose between different people who might pull you out of the pit? No, you're going to look at one person's and their hand, and you're going to put all your attention on reaching their hand and letting, being grasped, you know, and being pulled out of the pit. Okay. Now what happened in my case in phase two is I saw Jesus there. felt I was in the pit. I was just about ready to climb out of the pit. And I reached up for Jesus, said, "Here, help, 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 help." And he was sitting on this horse. And he was just like totally still and quiet and didn't make any change in expression or anything. It was just an absolute stillness. And I slid back into the pit and I said, "Wow, Jesus didn't help me." What was that? And then you start thinking, "Well, God, I need to find somebody else then. He didn't help me." So phase two is often where you go through this sort of global, this large ecumenical consideration, like, "Well, maybe there's, other teachers and they'll pull me out of the pit." And so sometimes, you may be interested in all sorts of different teachers. That can be part of phase two. Sri Sri Anandamaya Maharshi, maybe she'll pull me out of the pit. Or Mana Maharshi, you'll pull me out of the pit. Somebody, I know they will. How come Jesus didn't? And then they don't pull you out of the pit either. And you say, "Wow, I can't. What's wrong with me? Nobody will pull me out of the pit." So in phase three is this realization that nobody seems to be helping you. Nobody's pulling you out of the pit. And you say, "Why? Why? What's wrong? I don't quite get it." Then you take a closer look at it and you try to understand why did Jesus not pull me out of the pit? Why is nobody else pulling me out of the pit? Phase three ends and goes into phase four when you get the answer to this, really. It starts dawning upon you. Yeah, there is no pit. And if Jesus would have reached down to pull me out of that pit, he's only validating the pit. You see, can't do that. He knows there is no pit. So when you realize that, you just say, "Wow, this is a whole different ballgame." My God, that's when phase four starts. You segue into it. And it's just, "Oh my gosh, all I need to do is realize, accept the fact there's never been a pit. In fact, never a pit for anyone." And then you say, "Well, that's great news. In fact, it's such great news, I don't even know if I can handle this news. It's so great." It's like all these spirits in the one family are like sitting on the ground talking to themselves, "Oh my God, help, I'm in so much trouble. Oh, this is terrible, it's happening to me. How do I get out of this?" And they're like babbling on and on like lunatics. And all the while you can see that there is no pit. They're talking about how trapped they are in this horrible pit, this horrible darkness. "We're so trapped. Help, help, we're so trapped." They're not trapped at all. And really realizing that is this great feeling that really has no comparison or corollary. We can't say it's like this or like that. It's only like itself. It's only like itself. Or it's so wonderful. It cannot be damned with faint praise. We must not even damn it with faint praise or faint analogies or anything. It's just, you have to experience it. Experiencing this is called the vision of oneness. So space four prepares us to experience the vision of oneness, to abide in it. And many people have had glimpses, and they know they've had glimpses, and they say, "How come I cannot stay in this? What is the big deal?" Well, that's what the phases two, three, and four really get you up to speed more and more and more on this. Continuity fear. Wow. So, So you realize that the apparent insanity of all these spirits has no effect on them whatsoever. Their belief that they're in some pit, you see, their knife is so powerful that they must be in a pit and that you must be wrong. It's like, no, I must be hallucinating the lack of a pit. I mean, hallucination goes two ways. Okay, keep this in mind. You may hallucinate seeing something that's not there, or you may hallucinate not seeing something that is there. So here we are thinking, oh gosh, everyone seems like all these spirits here are insistent. They're in trapped in some horrible pit, and you don't see the pit at all. Like, well, I don't see it. And you think something's wrong with you. You think you must be hallucinating, and you have to be cured of that. The realization is, no, you don't have to be cured of that. You're right. There isn't any. They're the ones hallucinating. You're right, there's no pit. And then abiding in that is phase five, actually. So you can see that. If everybody insists they are in a pit and you don't see any pit, it's easy to think, to believe you're hallucinating, right? It's easy to believe that. So this is the struggle of the path, is to recognize that what you're actually seeing, which there is no pit, is right, is true. Accepting that. I had a dream once like that, where I came across this person who claimed to be very spiritual, who was really someone on the second phase, who was trying to work out a clever resolution to the second phase. Where they were still tempted by the continuity fear was still strong enough that they felt they needed to stop where they were, and so they needed to incorporate then the idea of that they've done the third and the fourth and the fifth, and you know, into there where they're actually stuck in the second. And so I came across them. They're all dressed in like a sadhu, holy person, mendicant, ultimate pilgrim look, and they chanting, and sitting in the lotus posture, and shaking, you know, doing the this and the beads, and you know, and just like everything was like completely decked out in spiritual attainment, right? Like that. and I said, you know, blessings, you know, what's going on? And they started ranting at me. Just complete blabber. Total blabber. Totally disconnected talk. It's just, you know, ranting and insanely. And then they'd stop and look at me like, did you get it? Do you understand what I said? As if they were the teacher and I was a student and I was supposed to understand what they said. And then they did it again very intensely. And then they said, you're not ready for me yet. And they went on doing their, you know, like prayer wheel or something. And, obviously you're not ready for me. I was like, wow, it's a very heavy situation. So you get that those who get stuck, they get stuck for some reason. Their habits and continuity fear, and somehow it happens that sometimes people get stuck. They may look at the world and see a lot of temptation there, and they think, wow, I don't really want to, you know, I want to have my cake and eat it too. What can I do, you know, like that. Then they get into this caricature of spiritual attainment. They become an actor or an actress acting out the role of spiritual attainment. And part of that is to you know, act out their confusion and then say, did you get it? Yeah, did you get it? And if you didn't get it, you're not ready for them yet. No. Well, look, you got to like serve me and take care of me and do all this stuff, because not able to really understand what I have to say. In fact, nobody can understand what I have to say. I'm so high and mighty that it's just not, it's not possible for you to understand my methods and what I'm conveying to you. It's hopeless, but you can at least try, and you can, you know, you'll get something, but you'll never really get the full transmission. No, no way. And so, is this caricature of spiritual attainment? And so that can be very unsettling. It's like, wow, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe seeing this, the total simplicity of it. See, they're throwing all this confusion at you and complexity, and you're saying, but I'm, Jesus said, to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be like a little child. What he's saying is, you must see the absolute simplicity of the truth, the self-evidency. You know, a child often has this very innocent, self-evident mind, right? And they just see what is happening, and they just is, you know, accurately. And those who are putting on an act, they can see, okay, it's just an act. Someone's acting this. And they say no to the child. No, 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 no. This is real. You're just not understanding. You know. So the childlike mind sees the simplicity of a situation. We see that there are no pits anywhere. No, everyone's just sitting on the ground of being. Everyone's immersed in the ground of being. Freaked out that they're not. You know, freaked out that they're not. Thinking they're not, and completely freaked out about it. Or being freaked out that they're going to lose it. That there's a trap door, and underneath them, poof, they're going to fall. But I know it's completely solid ground. Epstein, no, no, this is solid ground. There's no trap door. You're not sitting on something that's going to collapse. So the childlike mind, meaning that which trusts and believes in the simplicity, the truth of what they're seeing, a child will just see and cannot understand all the confusion. Just says, I don't see any confusion. I'm just, you know, just directly aware of it. That's how we have to be the fifth stage. That's how we are. We see the simplicity of it. And these people are ranting about how they're somehow curing the trapdoor problem. They found a cure for it. Or they're protecting everybody from falling into a pit. Or all this nonsense. You know, you just have to... You cannot bow to that. You cannot believe that you're in the position of the student and they're in the position of teacher. It simply isn't true. And there may be some that play the role so convincingly, you think that they'll never be cured. They're you know, but they're hard nut to crack. That's okay. Holy Spirit will cure them. Don't worry. Holy Spirit can effortlessly cure all of us. Has no trouble whatsoever with this. So sometimes there are those we simply have to give them some space. You know, just let it be. Let it be. They're too into their role. They don't want to get out of their role, you know, and so, okay. Let the Holy Spirit deal with that. That's fine. We're not on any crusade to crucify anyone. They're stuck for a little while with their continuity fear. You know, it's acting up. And they will say, hey, you know, they'll get through it. You might think it's tough for them. Yeah, it'll be tough for sure. But hey, join the crowd. It's tough for everybody. We've all been fools, you know, one way or the other, for sure. Continuity fear makes fools of us all, for sure. The Holy Spirit has no trouble with any of that. So, really, the true teachers aren't doing anything at all. They're not protecting us from falling into some pit. They're not compacting the soil, the ground of being, to make it so it can't be turned into a pit. The ground of being is pure, the pure zero-dimensional, pure spaciousness that is super-saturating all totality. There's no pit. Can there not be any pit in this allness, everywhereness, super-saturated everywhereness, right? It's impossible. There's no need to compact anything. There can be no trapdoor into anywhere, from somewhere into somewhere else. It's impossible. So they are truly just resting in absolute assurance that all is well. You can see examples of that. Like Ramana Maharshi, Nanda Mahima says. You can tell he has ecstatic joy, ecstatic bliss for you. They're so happy. They're just conveying to you. You don't have the slightest problem. At the same time, they understand, pragmatically, we have a severe continuity problem. But that's an issue of pragmatism, not an absolute, not an issue of the absolute condition. So they say, absolutely nothing is wrong with you, everything's perfect, and you need to practice accepting this. You need to give a lot of practice accepting this. So this is, you know, both the situations follow, right? They're together. Of course, that those who are in this failure success mantra mode want to crucify success. Of course they do. They're trying to crucify their own success. They're working at it night and day. They'll crucify yours if you agree to that too. Or they'll convince you need to crucify yours. Nobody can crucify your success, but others can certainly help convince you that you should crucify your own success. They certainly can do that. Accept the invitation to crucify their success, crucify the truth. They listen to the people, everyone talks to them, they're really saying, would you please help me out and crucify your success? That'll help you out a lot. And they smile. That's how one has to be in this world, to be helpful. Struggle with your thoughts. If your thoughts start going inward and struggling and trying to figure it out, no, full stop right there. Don't get into any struggle. There's continuity, fear talking. You're either in clarity or you're not. When you're in clarity, it's easy. You just flows. When you're struggling, you're experiencing continuity, fear. It's like if you're playing a musical instrument, you get into this groove, and it's just like you're completely riffing. It's just like, and then after a while, you realize, wow, I've just been totally incredible. It's just incredible. I'm just totally nailing it. This is great. You start, well, how did I do that? And then suddenly it starts, you start struggling. How was I so perfect? How can I do that again? And poof, vanishes, you know. Just vanishes like that. And you get so frustrated that they say, I gotta figure out how to, I'll just drop it, drop it, drop it, drop it. Nothing is wrong. Nothing needs to be done. No one's in any danger. No one's in any threat. And all I have to do is accept this fact. The joy of this fact. That's all I have to do. All we have to do is accept the joy of the fact. Joy of facts, which is that no one's ever been threatened. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. This is Jesus' summation of his teaching. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. You see, that's streamlining it to the ultimate. Jesus has responsibility for helping out the entire situation. So Jesus is involved in level phase 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, which is a huge responsibility. Very much so, which is why there's so many, many, many different concepts and attitudes around Jesus, so many idols and about him, and just, you know, it's just like everything. He gets everything. That's a lot of responsibility. Because you get the phase, you both get the ones who are unrepentant, you get the phase one, all the complexity of the phase one, all the upset of phase two and disappointment of phase two. It didn't pull me out of the pit, I'm very upset. Then you have the sort of positiveness of phase three, and then you have the good, really greatness of phase four. So it gets better. So you truly have to be absolutely unconcerned about any of that. Now, so Jesus doesn't seem to specialize in any one phase. He tends to encompass all the phases and do various help for all the phases. Sometimes you'll run into those who specialize in a particular phase, yeah? Wangchenpa tends to be focused more on fourth phase, freeing us into the fifth. It's like a baseball game, the closer comes in for the ninth inning. Very important to have a good closer. Jesus is like this manager saying, okay, I'm going to bring this closer in here in the last inning here to help close the game out. Not that these liberated ones aren't aware of all of it. Of course they are. They're involved in all of it too. I'm just giving examples of a big picture. How we should not initially worry about, oh, how do I handle phase one, two? How can I help others? All these different phases. That is too much burden for us, really, at this point, for sure. It's. You know, you just look at Christianity, for instance. I've looked at it my whole life, and you just have to shake your head. And there's so much variation, and also so much very off the wall speculation about Jesus and how they think he should be and what he should do for them, and it's just all over the map, and it's just wow. So that takes it like a perfect settledness on the part of Jesus. It's so completely settled in truth that nothing even has the effect of any sense of being dislodged from it, just from disappointment, you know, or dislodged at all. You can feel the fall in the air now. The evenings are cooling off. And you'll have different exercises for different phases, different teaching for different phases, different emphasis in the different stages. And of course, phase one thinks that that's it. They think this is the only phase there is. Because they don't want any complex. They're so tired of complexity. And they think they can say, you know what, phase two, three, four, that's too complex. I don't want that. So they try and, you know, short circuit what they need, which doesn't work. It's kind of a overreaction to the complexity. They're so tired of the complexity. They don't want any complexity. They just want to be told, you know, what to do. Say this prayer, do this, this. Go to Mass, take a wafer. It's that simple. It's that simple. You know, they just want to be told it's totally simple. They want to be told that, but they're not yet able to realize it. You see, so they want an institution like the Catholic Church to tell them how simple it is, which is very helpful, but the simplicity has to be truly seen and accepted from within each of us. We have to truly appreciate our success, actually. The simplicity of it results in our liberation from all concern and realizing that nothing real can be threatened, nothing wrong real exists, and it results in the vision of oneness, which is ecstatic. I mean, it's just tremendous. So, just being agreeing it's simple and having someone tell you, okay, this is the simplicity, that's not the vision of oneness, which is a relinquishment, a true relinquishment of the stance of hallucination. But people do need this time to be told it's simple, it's simple, it's simple. Just accept the fact it's simple. So, like the Catholic Church, for example, and other religions too, for example. But for example, Catholic Church does a world good, actually, by telling people it's simple, it's simple, it's simple, it's simple. Because remember, before people were converted, they were heathen, they were pagans, which is the essence of believing in complexity. Believing in triumph and defeat and complexity. Believing that failure is success and pursuing that. So coming from that, what you just want is you just want to be told over and over again, hey, it's really simple. It's actually simple. And you may spend lifetimes in absorbing this. Hey, it's simple. It's simple. It really is simple. Because you've been so freaked out thinking, because complexity is a defense, because it is simple. So we mesh ourselves in this extreme complexity, which is what this world is doing right now, this heathen world. The world is in the grip of heathen defensiveness and ideology, which is to make everything very complex. Not only actually, but potentially, ruinously complex. You know, someone with a sickness comes to Jesus, and Jesus just says, get up and walk. There's nothing wrong with you. There's nothing wrong with you. You're perfect. Everything's perfect. And so their continuity fear diminishes in the presence of Jesus to such an extent that they realize, oh, I don't need this complexity. I don't need this failure. I don't need it. And when they realize that I don't need this at all, gone. That appearance morphs into wellness. Instantly morphs, spontaneously, instantly morphs into wellness. The lame get up, crippled get up, gone. Just like that. Whereas the heathens, they say, oh, no, you need this. Yeah, you can't get rid of it. It is inevitable. But we're going to be able to do all these super complex advanced surgeries on you and treatments on you, replace your hips, and whoops, the hip replacement caused worse problems. Oops, we got to replace it again with something better. And healthcare becomes incredibly complicated and complex. Where Jesus just says, get up and walk, your faith made you whole. Your faith made you whole. Faith in what? Faith in Jesus, meaning what? Jesus' perspective, meaning what? Jesus seeing very clearly. Nothing real can be threatened and nothing unreal exists. That's it. If you want to know what Jesus is all about, and if you meet Jesus, what Jesus will tell you, it's right here. Jesus will say, nothing real can be threatened and nothing unreal exists. It's that simple. He doesn't have all these complexities going on in, you know, with him. He's capable of addressing all that, but he doesn't have these, he's not burdened by it in the slightest bit. He knows nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal can exist. And in the presence of that certitude, we say, wow, I feel that too. I know that is true. I know it's true. Oh, I don't need this complexity. I don't need it. Gone. Ultimately, all healing is instantaneous. We just do it a bit at a time, so it seems like, oh, it's not instantaneous. But each moment is instantaneous, however much we can accept. So all this bears repeating. A million times. It's like if you're thirsty, and you say, "Wow, I'm really thirsty." What do you do? You go for some water. You drink the water, and you say, "Oh, that was great. That really so quenched my thirst." Well, an hour later, you're thirsty again. Right? More water. An hour later, thirsty again. Spiritual path is the same. You get your sense of like big picture-ness, like, "Oh, wow, I can do this." Yeah, and then an hour later. You say, no, I don't think I can. You need to drink more assurance, right? More reassurance. So you need to hear over and over and over and over and over the basics. Just like water's the basic, right? Very basic. Also very effective. It's my favorite drink, water. So these pep talks are super important. Just like drinking water, you become thirsty for reassurance as this pressure of this world, for your attention to go on to the ways of failure, which they insist is ultimate success for you, and that you just lack patience to wait it out, whereas exactly the opposite. You need the patience to gradually back away from this insanity. And gradually realize, nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists. Nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists. Nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists. And say that over and over, nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists. And this will be very, very, very helpful. And I will continue, do the best I can to bring this reassurance, okay? That's enough for this one right now.